Our first reading this morning is Psalm 114. When Israel went out from Egypt, the house of Jacob from a people of strange language, Judah became God's sanctuary, Israel his dominion. The sea looked and fled. Jordan turned back. The mountains skipped like rams, the hills like lambs. Why is it, O sea, that you flee? O Jordan, that you turn back? O mountains, that you skip like rams? O hills, like lambs? Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God of Jacob, who turns the rock into a pool of water, the flint into a spring of water.
Our reading for this Sunday comes from the book of Joshua, chapter 3, verses 7 through 17. Last week we read about the end of the time in the wilderness. We heard about Moses' death. Moses got to see the promised land, but didn't get to enter it. And now we have moved to a new leader, and it is time to cross over into the promised land. Listen for the word of God to you as we hear the story of how it happened. The Lord said to Joshua, "This day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, so that they may know that I will be with you as I was with Moses. You are the one who shall command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan." Joshua then said to the Israelites, "Draw near and hear the words of the Lord your God." Joshua said, "By this you shall know that among you is the living God, who without fail will drive out before you the Canaanites, Hittites, Hivites, Perizzites, Girgashites, Amorites, and Jebusites. The Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of all the earth is going to pass before you into the Jordan. So now select 12 men from the 12 tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. When the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the Ark of the Lord of all the earth, rest in the waters of the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan flowing from above shall be cut off. They shall stand in a single heap." When the people set out from their tents to cross over the Jordan, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant were in front of the people. Now the Jordan overflows all its banks throughout the time of harvest. So when those who bore the ark had come to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the ark were dipped in the edge of the waters flowing from above stood still, rising up in a single heap far off at Adam, the city that is beside Zarethan, while those flowing towards the sea of the Arabah, the Dead Sea, were wholly cut off. Then the people crossed over opposite Jericho. While all Israel were crossing over on dry ground, the priests, who bore the Ark of the Covenant in the middle of the Jordan, stood still until the entire nation finished crossing over the Jordan. This is the word of the Lord. My formative years were in the golden age of email chain letters. I don't know if you remember these as well as I do, but as a preteen and a young teenager, I got access to email around the same time that people discovered it was way more efficient to send a chain letter if you didn't need a stamp, an envelope, or an address. And so people had started sending email chain letters all the time. I don't think I went a day without getting at least three of them around that time, maybe from 6th grade to 9th grade or something like that. And a lot of them, they had a distinct look about them. There were bright colored text on either a white background or a black background, and they wanted you to scroll down. And as you scrolled down, there'd be zigzags of arrows and sometimes designs all the way down to the bottom. And they would say things like, If you send this to 7 people in 7 minutes, then your crush is going to kiss you in 7 days. punishments. If you don't send them to 70 within 7 minutes, you'll be humiliated by your crush. I can confirm on both sides that this is not true. Now, there are a lot of different types of them. Some of them had jokes, some of them had sort of horoscopes or would tell you what your name means. I remember one time I was looking up what my name meant and I was scrolling through all the A's and the B's and I finally got to D and Drew and it said, Drew is stuck up and full of himself and he thinks he's awesome and he's really not. That was it. And one of these forwards, some of them were religious in nature, or inspirational at least, and one of them came to mind this week as I was preparing for my sermon. I'm almost sure that everybody has heard it before, but let me just sort of share a little bit of it. I had a dream one night that I was walking on the beach with my Lord. And I saw scenes from my life flashing in the sky. Oh, I see somebody, just realized. And while the scenes were flashing in the sky, I looked down and there were two sets of footprints in the sand. And I noticed that during the difficult times in my life, there were only one set of footprints. And I asked my God, why is it that during the hardest times of my life, there were only one set of footprints? Why did you abandon me during those difficult times? And my Lord said to me, I didn't abandon you. It was then that I carried you. Now this is not concurrent with the age of email forwards. It turns out it's actually a lot older. We don't really know how old it is, because we don't really know who authored it. At least 6 people, maybe as many as 12, claim to have been the person who wrote it. But that's how these kind of things go. But it showed up first in print in 1978. In the 80s and 90s, it was in all sorts of politicians' speeches. And there were at least 3 pop songs that made the charts that used it, including one not too long ago, 2009. But when it hit the internet did what the internet does, which is to spread it absolutely everywhere. And it became a little bit of a cliché to say that it was then that I carried you. Now, clichés are sort of a funny thing. They're tired old phrases, but the reason that they're tired old phrases is because they often have something that resonates with us. Something that feels sort of true and real, and sometimes that reflects poorly on us. Sometimes it resonates with maybe the worst angels of our nature. I think of the phrase, the old ball and chain. That's a cliche, and it sort of emphasizes this idea that marriage is more like a prison than a joy. But other cliches stick around because they resonate and they bring out a truth for us that reveals something profound and meaningful in our lives. And I would say that that's something true about that poem about footsteps in the sand. The story resonates because so many of us have experienced the feeling of being abandoned by God. And the story resonates because so many of us have looked back on our lives and we have seen times where God was with us, even though we didn't recognize it at the time. It was true even for the Hebrews in the wilderness, that sometimes we feel abandoned by God. Now, the Hebrews in the wilderness had it easier than just about anybody could have it, at least from that perspective. They were in the wilderness. But every morning they woke up and there was manna on the ground, and it was provided by God. And during the day they walked around and they followed a pillar of cloud that was the presence of God that would tell them where to go. And at night it turned into a pillar of fire, so they would be able to see it in the dark as well. And they brought with them the Ark of the Covenant in a tabernacle. And that carried with them God's real presence that was with them. And they carried it with them every day. And they were following Moses. Now, Moses had once seen God. So they had the only eyewitness that had ever existed. And when Moses saw God, his face was so transfigured by it, that he wore a veil the rest of his life so that he wouldn't terrify people. With just the sort of image of God that was burnt onto him, So they had, pardon me again. They had more evidence than anybody has ever had in the history of time that God was with them. And still, over and over again, we read story after story of the Hebrews complaining that God has abandoned them. It's just a truth about being a human, is that when things feel hard, we feel alone. In spite of whatever evidence is out there, whatever's going on in our lives, when things get rough, it makes us feel alone. And part of the human condition is learning that loneliness is not the truth. That the truth is that we're surrounded by friends and family and people who care about us. And that we walk with the presence of God with us. When Moses spent too much time talking to God, the Hebrews even created their own God. They made that golden calf. You know, the nice thing about idols, and an idol that you make can never leave you. There's a benefit to that. It can't, because it's a rock. You can't go anywhere unless you move it. But it didn't matter how much God did for them. They always had that feeling of loneliness, that feeling of abandonment. Now our story for today marks a crucial moment in this narrative. They had wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, but now they're about to cross over into the River Jordan, and they won't be wanderers anymore. They're going to be settlers. They had gathered up manna every day. They were gatherers. But they're going to go into the promised land, and they're going to plant, and they're going to reap. And they're going to raise cattle, and they're going to raise sheep. They were gatherers, but now they're going to be farmers. And out there in the wilderness, there's nobody out there but them and God. But now they are in the land of the Canaanites, and the Girgashites, and the Perizzites, and all of these other groups. They're going to have to interact with people. Everything is changing for the people of God when they cross this river. They're going from this wandering people in the wilderness with the presence of God with them into this whole new adventure. What is behind them is completely different from what's coming up in front of them. That might be true for some of us today. It might be true that you've got something big coming in your life, that there's some new adventure that you're about to embark on. Maybe you're getting married, or you're going to start a new job, or you just entered retirement, or there's some new big change that's going on in your life, and what is in front of you is completely different from what's behind you. I think, at the very least, it's true for all of us at some point in our lives that we run into situations like this. I remember when I was a teenager, I was going to go to this 3-week summer camp. It was completely different from anything that I'd gone before. I'd gone to summer camp before, but this was a different thing. And I remember I wanted to know what it was going to be like. And I had this sort of swirl of excitement and anxiety in me that kept me from sleeping. I struggled. I was just like, I don't know. It was a frustrating place to be. And the only thing that ever quieted it down, the only thing that quiets it down still when it comes up, is to tell myself out loud, I've got to say it out loud, I have no idea what it's going to be like, and there's nothing that I can do to figure it out. When I went to college, I had to tell myself the same exact thing. This is something that is completely different from everything I've done before, and I have no way of knowing or planning or changing anything to make it easier to handle that. That's a little bit of what's going on for the people of God as they're going into the promised land. What is in front of them is completely different from what's behind them. But listen to what happens when they start to cross the river. They bring the Ark of the Covenant before them and they send it first. That's a good move on their part. Whenever you're going into a dangerous situation, it's always good to sort of send God first, the most powerful one in the front. And the Ark of the Covenant is being carried by these 12 priests, and they walk into the river. The moment the soles of their feet touch the waters are cut off, and they walk across the river in dry ground. Now that is something that they've done before. When they were leaving Egypt, when Pharaoh's army was behind them, when Moses was with them, when they went up to the Red Sea, Moses stretched out his hand and he parted the waters, and the waters stood up in a heap. It's the same exact phrase. And the people walked across on dry land. What this is it's a reminder. It's a declaration by God that the same God that brought them out of Egypt is bringing them in to the promised land. And everything else might have changed, and things might get rough. Who am I kidding? We know the story. Things will get rough. But one thing does not change, and that is that God is with them. I will be your God, and you will be my people. At that moment that they're crossing over into something new, God gives them this reminder of how far God has brought them. The Lord who brought you up, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, who provided manna for you in the wilderness, and a pillar of cloud, and a pillar of fire, and the Ark of the Covenant itself. That is the Lord who is going with you into your new adventure. That is the one who's going with you into the promised land. You might be learning a new job, or developing new skills, or live in a different place than you lived before, but God, the God that got you here, is the God that is going with you into that new world. That is the promise in this miracle. That's the promise that God is making to the Israelites, and that's the promise that God is making to us. Is that same God that we recognize when we look back in our lives at all of the troublesome times, at all the times that God has carried us, at all the times that God has been with us when we felt so alone, that is the God who is going with us into the new world. Now, I don't really know exactly how everything ended on that day. The next chapter tells us how Joshua sent 12 people into the dry river bottom to dig up 12 big rocks and planted them at Gilgal, which is a place. And I think Joshua knew that even crossing over a river on dry ground, that wasn't going to be enough. We need constant reassurance that God is with us. And so he brought those stones out. And I imagine that the priests, after everybody had crossed, when Joshua sent people back in there, were getting a little bit tired of carrying the Ark of the Covenant on their shoulders, getting a little bit tired in their feet. Having carried it the whole time when every single member of the nation of Israel trudged across the river. And so I have no idea if any of them looked back. But I imagine if when they left the river, if one of them just tossed a backwards glance, I can imagine that he would have seen one set of footprints there in the river.